there's 2.2 million people on this platform.
Yeah.
There are 25,000 partners. But there's about, I think I said, 180,000 affiliates. Wow. You guys are still, like, it feels like that everybody gets affiliate. But that's because a lot of us associate most often with other streamers around our size.
That's true.
So, yeah, there's a lot of affiliates, but you're still less than, that's what, less than a percent of the overall population of Twitch. Just
what's going on, everybody? Welcome to the Stream Key Podcast, episode 6. I'm here today with our special guest, Pimz. I almost said your first name there. That's out for that.
Yeah.
Pimz, thank you for coming in, dude. He's all the way from Canada. You guys probably know he's from Canada by this point.
Long trek by moose.
Yeah. How's it been so far?
It's been good. There's been a lot going on. Yeah.
Enjoying the freedom, the real freedom of this country.
I haven't had much free time, so no.
No. Okay. Yeah. Well, you've been all over the place. They went to Michigan and New York and now North Carolina.
That's
crazy. Yeah. Seeing the whole country.
Yeah, Michigan and Carolina are both firsts for me. I've been to New York before.
Okay, gotcha. Yeah, New York is one of the places you have to go if you're in America, kind of. Yeah. So, awesome. If you guys don't know, Stream Key is our podcast where every week we focus on ways that you can grow as a streamer on Twitch, Mixer, YouTube, platforms like that. Primarily Twitch is our focus, and today we're going to be talking about something really cool that Pimz is really passionate about, and I am too, but Pimz specifically kind of came to me and said, hey, I want to talk about this on the show. I really care about this, and that is identity on Twitch. The idea of how you make yourself stand out on Twitch, what your thing is kind of on Twitch, and why people should watch you over anyone else on the platform. And it's a really tough question, but I'm excited to get into it. Real talk, before we do that, though, I want to quickly talk about Pimz for anyone who doesn't know who Pimz is. So do you want to quickly talk about how you got started on Twitch and how long you've been on there, that kind of stuff?
I honestly don't even remember how I got started, but I've been on Twitch a little over 2 years now. It was October 2015 when I first started fairly seriously streaming. So a little over 2 years at this. Been doing the variety thing and a bunch of different approaches to it throughout that time, trying to figure out what works for me and what works most for my community.
Right.
Huge focus on community building. That's been something I've been working on for a long time.
Us too, for sure.
Yeah.
Awesome. And you mainly do variety still.
Yeah.
Have you always done variety? Have you ever focused on one game?
The closest I had was over the summer. I binged almost 300 hours of PUBG.
Of course.
And now my PC doesn't even run it, but that's a story for another time. Oh, man.
I feel like you can still be a variety streamer and play a lot of PUBG.
Yeah.
From what I've seen.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
That's funny. Awesome. Quickly, just a few more questions about yourself. Do you have any streamers that you look to as inspiration on Twitch?
Definitely, yeah.
Yeah.
Probably the one streamer that got me the most interested in full-time streaming is Wolves at My Door. Some people might know him as Jason the Nicest. He used to use that as a username on, I think that was on YouTube. He's a partnered streamer. His sub community is the Wolfpack, which a lot of my subs now are actually people I met through the Wolfpack.
Oh, cool.
And they watch me as much as they watch him, which is kind of flattering in its own respects.
Wow. That's awesome.
I also look up to Lieutenant Eddie. He's a Canadian streamer. you might know him from, he did some Source Filmmaker animations for Game Grumps around, I can't remember, it's one of the like digital novels,
right?
So they're pretty interesting. He does a lot of mishap videos, streams fairly full time. He's really grown a lot recently, and I draw my inspiration knowing that, you know, there are Canadian streamers that can get that big.
Yeah, that's true.
Just kind of to keep me going.
Yeah. Awesome. Well, yeah, it's cool that you are inspired by him, and even that people that you, Jumama's doing funny things in the window right now.
Yeah.
It's cool that people that watched him now watch you.
Yeah.
That probably means that you're doing something right, I feel like. So, and then lastly, what do you do when you're not streaming? This is a fun little question I like to ask.
I work a lot.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm, so I run the True Talk podcast every other week.
Which you guys should all go listen to. It's great.
Yeah. We put a decent amount of effort. I won't say a lot. It's pretty
it's not
very
no
open. It's a little less structured than Stream Key.
Right.
We're going to try and learn a few things from that. I work full time as a software developer up in Canada, just something to keep the lights on, keep the bills paid until I can hopefully make something a little more out of this.
Right. Yes.
Does she do this all the time?
Yes, she does it every time. Okay. She's still doing funny things in the window, guys. Yeah. Don't worry. That's cool. I think everybody's trying to get to that point at some point on Twitch.
Yeah. So. Even if I can pay rent and work a part-time job on top of that, that would be, like, that's my ideal.
Yeah, just having that much to kind of make up for less work time, right?
Yeah.
That's the goal. Yeah. Awesome. Cool. Well, real quick before we get into the meat of this discussion, I do want to say that we'll take questions from Twitch chat later on, guys. We're not looking at Twitch chat just right now. Yeah. But later on the show, if you have a question for us, if it's just for me or Pimz or anything, or if you have a question about identity, which we're going to be talking about, please feel free to ask us and we will do our best to help you. Yeah. But with that said, let's go ahead and get right into the discussion, which is finding your identity as a streamer, which is a big topic.
Yeah.
So let's define that first. What do you exactly mean by the idea of an identity as a streamer?
So when I say identity, it's not something like a persona or, you know, a character you assume it on stream. It's not like Dr. Disrespect. It's kind of the core values that you and your community follow. Heavily, it's more often than not heavily influenced by the community because they see things very differently than you do.
Right.
So it's all about like what you represent as a collective as much as it's about, you know, what you inspire from your community as a streamer.
Right. Yeah, I definitely get that. Yeah, it's a big topic. It's kind of hard to define because it's such a vague word. But it really is something that you have to think about if you want to get anywhere on Twitch, because I think it's easy to turn on your stream and just stream for hours and hours and just play games.
Yeah.
But if you don't figure out what your identity is, then probably no one's really going to watch you, or you're going to have a hard time growing at least.
Yeah.
So.
And it can be anything from, you know, so Wolves at My Door. He's not a pro gamer. That's not his identity. He's very, I've borrowed a lot from him. He's one of my biggest inspirations. He's very community driven. You know, you go into chat, doesn't matter if it's been 8 months since you were in there last. You get a welcome from him. You get a welcome from chat. Like it's an open and welcoming community.
Yeah.
But at the same time, you know, for some people, like Summit, actually Summit's a bit of an interesting one because he still has a lot of the community stuff. He does still catch a lot of chat and talk to people.
Yeah.
But he's more primarily a competitive gamer.
That's, yeah.
Yeah.
He's interesting because he doesn't really specialize in any one game anymore.
No, that's been cool to see.
Yeah. It's interesting. I think there are a lot of streamers who, if you look at like the very high end, they're both good entertainers and good players at whatever game they're playing. Yeah. I think if you look at just the highest streamers in every category, I think they're pretty decent at the game they're playing.
Yeah.
Like there really aren't that many bad players that are still really popular on Twitch. So I think skill does have a factor on it, but it's not everything for sure.
Yeah, and that's one of the factors of identity that's kind of more vague and maybe not something I'll spend as much time on, because it's 100% an individual thing. That's not something that everybody needs to fit a certain mold in or something like that. You know, there's a varying skill level.
Yeah, absolutely.
Even in TruFam, there is a very wide skill gap there.
Definitely is. So yeah, that's definitely something you have to find out for yourself, I think, in terms of whether that's for your stream or not. But so why did you want to talk so badly about this topic on the show?
So this one came up a bit just watching kind of the big Warframe event that's been going on. There's been a lot of people. I have been watching a little bit of it. And a few of the streamers that I went in and watched, you know, they weren't necessarily having fun with it. They were just kind of in there playing to try and build the community. Even if they didn't intend to stay there for the long term.
Yeah.
Which to me, like I stayed out of Warframe because the game doesn't interest me.
Yeah.
You
think people just kind of taking advantage of the hype, you think?
Yeah.
More than really being interested in the game, I guess.
Yeah. And that's a very common thing. And I found myself doing it.
Yeah.
With some games. Like I love Overwatch, but I don't play it much anymore because it doesn't, It's a lot of my viewers have said, you know, it's kind of hard to watch sometimes because there's so much going on.
It's true.
And it's not. So I specialize in like indie and story based games. excuse me, primarily because that's like, it's like sitting down and watching a movie with friends most of the time.
Yeah.
And that's a part of my identity as a streamer, right?
Right. That's something you define for your own channel.
Yeah.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. Like, I think there are some channels that, like we've already talked about, that do competitive things like that pretty well, even with Overwatch streams.
Yeah.
And that's a different type of viewer, right, than
yeah.
maybe someone who comes to your channel and is just looking for more of a casual thing.
Yeah.
Cool. So what are some of the big mistakes that you see people making on Twitch in relation to identity?
There's a lot of people that so this one's kind of a double-edged blade. There's a lot of people that try to be exactly like their favorite streamers.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they try to be exactly like Tim the Tatman, Summit, Dr. Disrespect, all these big names.
Mm-hmm.
And it works to an extent, but there's a certain point where that needs to morph from being... Like, I highly recommend taking notes based on the streams that you watch the most.
Yes, I agree.
That is one of the best ways that I've found for finding the identity.
Mm-hmm.
But it shouldn't be that is your identity, that the streamers you watch should not be who you are.
Yeah.
You need to have your own identity. You need to just... I feel like I'm going to be tired of saying identity by the end of this. You need to really focus on what makes your channel and your community unique.
Yeah.
And what keeps everybody there happy.
Right.
Yeah.
I feel like some people might not know where to start with that. Do you have any like practical ways to think about starting identity?
Like I said, look at the streamers you watch the most. If you're mm-hmm. thinking about starting watching, if you watch Doc full time on the TRUgaming channel, you know, take a look at what you enjoy about his stream.
Mm-hmm.
Or, you know, if you watch some of the larger streamers, take a look at what you enjoy most. Everything from, you know, your channel branding. So brand mm-hmm. and identity are something that are mixed together, but they're still separate things.
Yeah.
So take a look at their branding because it does play a part in it, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I'm very minimalistic because, like I said earlier, I focus on the game. It's about enjoying the game. But some people have very complex setups. You know, they've got, I think it's Gather has pets.
Yeah.
All kinds of stuff like that. Mm-hmm. Bit bosses and so on and so on.
There's a lot of room for variation out there for sure.
Yeah. So it's perfectly fine to just pick and choose and just make sure you find something that kind of becomes your own thing.
Mm-hmm.
Like you need to like I've for a while I have my full screen camera and I've got an image off to the side that like fades in.
Mm-hmm.
I've taken that and adjusted how I present it. I originally took the idea from Lol Renee.
Right.
When she's on her full cam, she's got a red gradient. I took my branding and applied a gradient to it and then mm-hmm. used that. So, yeah, that's the biggest thing is just kind of looking at what you enjoy most Absolutely. When you're starting up.
Yep.
And building on it. Don't just let it stagnate. You got to be very, very mindful, very active about maintaining mm-hmm. Your identity as much as you are with maintaining your brand.
Yeah. I think there's a lot of good stuff in there. One, you said just, I think, really paying attention to the streams that you like, what you like about them, and like writing it down. Like, really, it's easy to watch a stream and just be entertained, but you have to really be active in your watching to kind of think about, okay, why am I enjoying this stream right now? Yeah. What is this guy doing that I could do on my stream? Like, what is he doing that I love? And then writing that down. And that's kind of what Sodomi touched on, I think, on our last episode, like the idea of becoming an idea thief, basically.
Yeah.
I think it's a really good way to do it. So that's a good way to start, I think.
So the other thing when you're starting up is if you already have a group of people,
mm-hmm.
talk to them about what they like as well.
Yes.
One of the best things I've done in recent months for kind of understanding where my stream's at identity-wise now is I actually set up a Twinge and got some of my regulars to go give an honest review.
Mm-hmm.
And the biggest thing is they all say, you know, dad jokes, welcoming community, you know, mm-hmm. Canadian charm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's part of your branding or your identity really now, right?
Yeah.
Like people talk about, you know, Canadian Pimz all the time, maple syrup,
yeah.
If zero's in the chat. But that's kind of who you are, right? It kind of adds to your channel. So I think it's cool to think about, like, even memes can be part of your identity, really.
Supervid, part of his identity is literally the word memes.
Yeah, it's true. That's,
yeah, we had an entire True Talk podcast on that.
Super meme, I think, is what Velvet called him. Yeah. So that's awesome, though. And you mentioned just being consistent about it. I think people can sometimes, one thing I've been thinking about a lot with streaming is the idea of streaming just because you can. Yeah. Like, I think sometimes it's risky just to turn on a stream because you have some extra time and stream if you're not in the mentality of what your stream consistently is. It's you might argue that it's more valuable to have less streams and be more on during those streams than to stream all the time and only be on sometimes during those streams. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Up until recently, I've streamed three nights a week kind of thing.
Yeah.
Like it's been, or four, I think. Because I come home from work a lot of the time and, you know, I'm tired.
Yeah.
My job's been taking a lot out of me, so I've dialed things back a little bit. And I'm starting to get my energy back, get better health, and now I'm dialing it back up again. But there are people that stream 7 days a week, and, you know, I've come to a few of them and said, you know, maybe you might want to think about dialing it back. You know, things haven't been quite as good.
Yeah. Some people do a great job of that, even when streaming for 8 hours. Like Doc, for example, he streams all day. I couldn't do that.
Nope.
I just don't have the same energy. But if you can be on for all those hours, then that's really the best way to do it.
Yeah.
Just kind of figuring out what you have the ability to do on your stream.
Yeah. And that ties into the individuality. Like there are people that stream 18 hours a day sometimes.
That's crazy.
And I'm sitting here and some nights I struggle through three.
Yep. I struggle for like one, man. I did one for the charity stream. Yeah. I was like, man, I'm ready to, I got to stop. I'm running out of energy here. But so just finding your own kind of niche, I guess, with where your energy level is and all those sorts of things.
Yep.
Okay, let's keep going here. So are there any examples of streamers on Twitch that you think do a really good job with creating identity? Maybe like people that you know more personally, because it's easy to say somebody
it's easy to point out partners.
Yeah. Or anyone who's big clearly has some sort of identity on the channel.
Dan the Dapper does a really good job. He's spent a lot of time, you know, asking people.
Yeah.
And working with others to try and figure out, you know, what his community actually is recently, especially since he's gone full-time, more or less.
Yeah.
Dan's really good. Velok has an incredibly unique identity.
Yeah.
Very loud. Very, very free.
Yeah, Velok's interesting. We were kind of talking with him at TwitchCon about it because he was kind of struggling with it about where to take it. But I agree. Those are both really good examples of people in the community who have identity, I think.
Sodomi is one, actually. Yes. He stuck out to me just from the 20-minute TwitchCon video.
Yeah.
He's...
And you hadn't even met him, right? You just saw the video.
I was like, I want to get to know this guy. So I'm watching his stream once or twice a week now while I'm at work.
Yeah. Awesome. Yeah, he's a really energetic guy for sure. Yeah. He's the only one I saw do a handstand in the middle of TwitchCon floor. So that's one way to make an identity for yourself for sure.
No, he has a completely different energy than anyone I've ever watched. That is something unique.
Absolutely.
And he's very, very responsive and warm. He's a very warm person. I think it was you or Doc were saying, like, he'd be there 1 second and then you'd look back and he's just gone and he's off with this group of like 20 people that he just met.
Pretty much, making friends with like partners. Yeah. No big deal.
So that's actually a good example of a very strong identity. I haven't even, like, I barely know the guy and I'm referencing him on something like this. So
yeah.
That's the kind of thing that you want to look for as far as making yourself stand out and helping your community build an identity.
Yeah.
So I keep referencing community as part of your identity. And it's like, because Twitch is a viewer-based and community-based platform, they're extremely important to this. There's kind of the two ends of the spectrum for how people tend to build their streams, and it's either you spend a lot of time with your viewers, you really get to know them. Doesn't matter if you have 5 or 500 people in chat, you know everyone there.
Yep.
They all feel welcome. They come because they genuinely feel that it's a place, it's a safe place for them. Like it's a place with friends.
Right.
Which is, I love that aspect because it's great for healing. like learning to deal with anxieties. Just kind of understanding that you're not alone in a lot of respects, and that's been one of my biggest things on Twitch. It's helped me get through a lot of anxiety issues that I've been working through.
Did you, this is kind of a tangent, but did you see Dr. Disrespect's speech from last night?
No, I missed it.
So he won Streamer of the Year from some sort of esports industry award show. And even he, you know, probably one of the biggest streamers on Twitch at this point. When he got up there, he started talking about how he's realized that his stream is a way for him to help people get through hard times in life and deal with really hard situations. So even at that higher level, you can still make that happen. And really know viewers semi-person. Now, he doesn't know every viewer in his chat when he's got 30,000 people watching him.
Yeah.
But he still is able to kind of have the impact, I think, that you're talking about. And so, like, it's easy, I think, also to, if you have a lot of energy on stream, it's easy to play that up as part of your identity, right?
Yeah.
And not everybody has it on Twitch. I think probably most people don't have a lot of energy on Twitch just because of the nature of gamers, introverts. Both of us, I think, don't have as much energy as some other people.
Yeah, definitely not.
Naturally. Yeah. And you can use it and you can make yourself more energetic, but it's going to take a toll on you.
Yeah.
As opposed to somebody like Sodoma, you can go all day and probably be fine and not feel any worse about it.
Yeah.
But I think a good way to adapt to that is to kind of like play to your strengths. So maybe if you're not the most energetic person, but you're really good at a game, you can focus on that one game or something.
Yeah, absolutely.
Or community, like you said, if you're really good at just talking to people, maybe you're not like screaming and bouncing off the walls all the time, having really kind of like soft conversations with people. And I don't know, just the idea of finding whatever you're good at and honing in on that. You don't have to be really energetic to be a good identity streamer, if that makes sense.
Yeah, you don't have to be, like, you can look at any of the most successful streamers on Twitch, any of the partners. You don't have to be anything like any of them.
Mm-hmm.
You can be your own. You may have similarities. You may have things that you borrow from them. Like I said, you know, that's a very important part of all this.
Yeah.
But you don't have to be exactly like them. You know, and it's almost unhealthy in some respects to constantly compare yourself like that.
Yeah, for sure. Absolutely.
Which is, I guess that's another, just rewinding back to the mistakes thing. That's a mistake I know quite a few people who have done, and they've quit streaming because of it.
Mm.
You know, they constantly compared themselves to the people they draw inspiration from, and it took a toll.
I could definitely see that.
Caught up with them, yeah.
For sure. And I think, like, there's danger in that when you look at people who are doing 24-hour streams or just streaming for 16 hours a day and feeling like, well, I'm not streaming 16 hours a day. Like, am I really a good streamer? I think you can't let that impact you, because there's no right way to stream, right?
No.
It's just finding whatever works for you. And maybe you don't want to be a full-time streamer. You don't need to stream 16 hours a day.
Yeah.
It's, you know, doing what you can with the time you have. And again, like we keep saying, just finding what works for you and sticking to it, I think.
Yeah.
So,
little just kind of off the racket piece of advice specifically for affiliates. There's 2.2 million people on this platform.
Yeah.
There are 25,000 partners. But there's about, I think I said, 180,000 affiliates.
Wow.
You guys are still, like, it feels like that everybody gets affiliate. But that's because a lot of us associate most often with other streamers around our size.
That's true.
So, yeah, there's a lot of affiliates, but you're still less than a percent of the overall population of Twitch. You're still doing things well, even if it doesn't feel like you have the biggest community, or maybe things have been stagnant for a month.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that one always burns.
Yeah,
I've been fighting that for a long time.
It happens.
It happens. It's a fact of the platform, and that's one of the good spots to go, okay, I need to make some adjustments. Go take another look at the people that you watch in your time, in your downtime.
Mm-hmm.
And see if there's anything they've changed that could potentially benefit you. Yeah. Or go talk to your community and be like, hey, things have been slow, and I want to try and get things going again.
Right.
And get honest and genuine feedback from them. One of the things I've recommended for a lot of people, a good chunk of the sponsored streamers, is get yourself a Discord, get yourself a questions and feedback channel. Because that has been one of my favorite things that I did in recent months, Discord-wise.
Yeah, I think getting feedback's really important, for sure.
Yeah.
even if you're not doing a Discord, like literally you could just do a Google Forms with anonymous things. Yep. That takes like 5 minutes to set up. And just getting some sort of like feedback on how your channel is doing.
Yeah.
I think also self-criticism is important. Yeah. We've talked about this a little bit on past episodes, but looking at your own past broadcasts, if you don't do that, start doing it like tonight. Like go back at least once a week and look at your VODs and see, what am I doing that I love right now? Like, what are the things that are working? What are the things that I don't like? Like maybe I'm biting my nails, or I'm like getting up and talking on the phone or something, or I'm just sitting there in silence for 5 minutes. Like, you don't need to have someone else to tell you that. If you just go back and look yourself, it saves so much effort and gives you so much helpful feedback for yourself.
Yeah.
So that's a good way to do that too. Okay, cool. We'll keep moving along here. So this is an interesting one. I'm curious if you have an answer for this. Any examples of streamers that you think didn't have an identity who recently found one? Or maybe not recently, just at some point didn't have one and then eventually kind of found their own identity on Twitch.
I mean, my own stream notwithstanding.
Yeah, you could talk about that too, I think, honestly. So,
yeah, when I first started streaming, I played a lot of multiplayer games. I played a lot of Gmod, a lot of games that I wouldn't normally play.
Right.
Because that's what I saw people doing on YouTube, and I was like, hey, they're, it's that's working for them. Yeah, it's working for them. Yeah. It can probably work for me. And then along the way, I kind of learned that, you know, indie games, story-driven games work way better for me as a streamer.
Right.
It keeps me, especially the ones I get excited about, like Oxenfree. I absolutely love that game. I need to go back and play it some more. And then, like, that kind of unique, stylized, story-driven, very, very... almost thought-provoking game works great for me, because I'm sitting there and, you know, I'm pretty good at solving puzzles, but at the same there while I'm solving those, I'm also kind of puzzling through, you know, pieces of the story and stuff like that, just to keep myself talking, to keep what I consider entertainment coming out of my channel
for sure.
I don't think so. A lot of the people around my size are, and even the people I'm around with True, a lot of them have already an established identity. But I think as part of a point for this one is there are a lot, you know, I talked about Dan talking about his identity. Just that, there's a lot of that around. There's a lot of people that maybe like, They come to others for help with the identity when they don't think they, or when they think they've lost it.
Yeah.
I see that more so than I see streams that don't have identity at our level.
Yeah.
There are a few smaller streamers that, you know, they're just getting started and they're doing the same thing where they're going, well, this works for someone else, instead of, can I make this work for myself? That's kind of the big question here.
Exactly.
Yeah. That kind of the two sides of that.
Yeah. One thing I think, specifically with sponsored streamer applications, identity is one of the biggest things that hold people back. Like you cut out, let's say you get 200 applications. You can cut out probably half of that for people who just don't have followers or aren't consistent or have some other major issues that are just very baseline.
Yeah.
But identity is kind of that second level where it's something that you can't really, you're not going to find identity and you Google like, how to grow on Twitch or like like basic things for setting yourself up on Twitch. You can have a great stream on paper, like all the audio is great, you're on there constantly, you stream consistently, you everything you get, everything seems good, but if I come to your channel and it's just lifeless, and that's the hard thing to teach, because that's something that you can't really have anyone else tell you as much as you have to find for yourself. Now you can have feedback from other people. And I think like a good way to kind of find your identity is to ask people what they think of you and your channel. Like, you know, when you think of my channel, what do you think of? And maybe with like Supervid, for example, it's memes. Like, I always think of memes when I think of Supervid. Like, maybe he had no idea about that. And then by asking someone, you got that idea. But at the end of the day, you're the one who kind of has to decide your own identity.
Yeah.
So that's kind of just a tangent that I see a lot. And we get a lot of applications who, you know, everything is great on paper. Like I just said, they seem like great candidates. but they're just, there's nothing happening in the channel. Either they're like extremely boring to watch, or not extremely. Very fringe.
Yeah.
Or there's just nothing there. Like there's no special identity. That's the word. Yeah. So cool. We will keep moving on here. What's one piece of advice that you would give the streamers looking to create a more defined identity on their channels?
I've already kind of given this piece of advice, and it is the one about involving your community.
Okay. Yeah.
The more involved the people you work with, or the people in your chat are with your identity as a stream, the more likely they are to come back. The more likely you are to get genuine, like good, wholesome feedback. Mm-hmm. Not just, oh yeah, you're doing great. And stuff like that. You know, always involve your community. I'm very, very community driven, so it's a little bit biased.
Right.
But that is probably the biggest piece of advice, is even if it's one person,
mm-hmm.
involve a moderator in figuring this out.
I totally agree. One thing I will say is I think that kind of applies to channels that have like at least somewhat of an audience already. Yeah. Like let's say you don't have a community. What would you say to those people who really are just kind of starting from ground zero or are just looking for that baseline?
So at that point, I'd go even further back to the, I'd go back to my question, you know, what can I make work for me?
Mm-hmm.
Like what do the people that I look up to do
mm-hmm.
that, you know, I enjoy and I think others would enjoy and that I think I could do well?
Yes, exactly.
That is your best starting point. And it's going to change a lot.
Mm-hmm.
Like that, it changes almost on a monthly basis for some people.
Right.
Like that's depending on what games are out, you know, what games people are asking you to play.
Mm-hmm.
For instance, you know, Overwatch. My feedback with Overwatch was it's not great for us to watch, but we have trouble not filling a squad whenever I say, hey, you guys want to play Overwatch? Like that's...
Hmm. That's interesting.
Yeah. And also don't take any feedback personally.
Yeah.
It's always feedback on the channel.
That's true. Not you, right?
Not you.
As a person.
Yeah. Yeah, because yeah, there's some great people out there that that, you know, they probably won't get great feedback on their channel because there's certain things that still need improvement.
And yeah, that's true.
That's a fact of life. That's, you got to treat it a little bit like a business in that respect.
Absolutely.
It's not a criticism so much as feedback for you to improve on.
Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely. I think I totally agree with both of those things. If you have somewhat of a community already, just to use that community and look for feedback constantly. And then if you're really starting from just the base level, just to look at things to copy from other streamers, like you said, and to stick with it, like to set, I don't know, maybe a month or so where you're going to do this every day for a month. Because you have to make sure that you're doing it for long enough to make an impact.
Yeah.
You know, you can't just decide you're going to be Tim the Tap Man one day on stream and just talk and scream the whole day. And then the next day you're dead as a doornail and don't say anything. Like you have to make it consistent is my little add on there.
But yeah.
I totally agree with that stuff. So cool. That's most of the stuff I want to talk about. Is there anything else you want to talk about in relation to identity or just in general about streaming? Anything like that?
That's about all I kind of had ready to talk about today.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. Awesome. Well, we will go ahead and take some Twitch chat questions if you guys are hanging around, and we'll pull up our tablet, which has been showing here for a bit because we haven't looked at it at all. So if you guys have questions for us about anything at all for me and Pimz, it could be related to streaming or just gaming in general, things like that, please let us know. In the meantime, I want to ask you, do you have any special stream plans for the rest of the year or anything for holidays? Or
I need to get... I have about 12 hours of extra lifetime that I owe for this year.
Oh, really? Okay.
I need to finish up. Really excited thing thing happened in the extra life world for the Stollery Children's Hospital, which is my local hospital.
Oh, cool.
There was a $30,000 challenge from, I think it's the ESA, that the top fundraiser, or top fundraised hospital, and the hospital with the most fundraising per person.
Hmm.
Would get an additional $30,000 US. So being a Canadian hospital, that's a lot of money. We won the most fundraising per capita.
Wow, that's crazy.
I think I had somebody roll by on the morning of. I was getting ready to board my flight down to Michigan, and I just checked my emails, and I have a $150 donation out of nowhere. Anonymous. I have no idea who it is.
Wow.
Like, just...
That's nice.
That bumped it up. So we won that. That was fantastic. That was kind of really cool, especially because I've been working so much with Extra Life.
Right.
Especially, like, the Extra Life Edmonton community.
Yeah, that's where you're from, kind of.
Yeah.
Awesome. Well, that's really cool. I know... You talked about, we kind of like had some sort of support for that, I think.
Yeah. Yeah. We had some door prizes.
Yeah. That's right.
I think I gave them something like 50 lanyards to give away.
Awesome.
So those are out and about.
True spreading, guys.
Yeah.
Everyone's going to have them soon. Yeah. Okay. We have our first question from Eshnid. He says, is it ever bad to try to refine your identity on Twitch? You want to take that?
Never.
Yeah.
That is a one word answer. Mm-hmm. It's never bad to try and refine your identity.
I totally agree with you. I think. I really think you should kind of rethink about your identity every once in a while, like no matter how good your identity is, and just make sure that's something that you like and that you think is working and that other people's like too, people like.
I'm constantly doing it. Like I said, you know, I have the feedback channel and I ask something like every couple of days, like, hey, are you guys enjoying this? Mm-hmm. Would you be interested in this? Let me know what you think of these changes I've made to the channel.
Right.
Just like constantly little things like that.
Yeah, I totally agree with that.
And that's like, even if you're driving down a straight stretch of road, you're still making little adjustments to the wheel to stay on it, right?
Yeah. I totally agree with that. Finding things that, like even little things that aren't working and just cutting them out, writing new things. You don't have to completely change your identity, although you can if you need to, I think.
Yeah.
So Malicious Advice asks Pimz, do you feel having consistent giveaways can be considered important to an identity to give back to your viewers? That's an interesting question.
That's an interesting and loaded question,
yeah.
I think. Because giveaways are kind of a double-edged sword.
Mm-hmm.
Right? They're going to bring a lot of people to your stream, but you'll probably only really see those people for the giveaways.
Mm-hmm.
So personally, if I'm doing a giveaway, I do it in the Discord so that, you know, my community has the best chance of getting them. That being said, if you are focused on something like fundraising, those giveaways and that coverage that you can get can be extremely beneficial. But depending on what you're going for, I don't think it would be. From my perspective, it's kind of it can be a huge money sink for one.
It definitely can be.
Like I said, it's kind of a loaded question. It's a bit difficult to answer properly, especially considering how personal identity as a streamer is.
Exactly.
Like it
kind of depends on what you want to do too with your channel, right?
Yeah.
I agree. So, I think. Sorry, I'm interrupting you.
Oh, I was just going to say it's kind of a vague answer. I don't know if I fully answered it.
Right. It's a tough question for sure.
Yeah.
I would have said no to this question, except I know Doc has talked to me recently about Cone Carnage. I don't watch a lot of Cone Carnage, but supposedly he gives stuff away almost every day on a stream and like various tiers of giveaways to the point where it's become like a real part of his channel. And so in that sense, I think some of his identity is probably tied to giveaways. Not all of it for sure, but that's definitely part of his channel. So I think if you do giveaways the right way, they can be part of your channel in terms of identity, but they're very tricky, like you said. You really have to do them right and not kill yourself just spending so much money on giveaways that you can't afford other things. So cool. So Khaleesi's just making comments in chat. Any other questions from people in the chat who have questions about identity or just in general for me and Pimz about anything at all? Memes, Christmas, True Mama, whatever. There's lots of things. Also, Malicious has another comment. Pimz, your channel identity reflects who you are, but if you find yourself with few viewers or few subs, etc., how do you avoid the temptation to try becoming something you're not? Interesting. That's a tough one.
Yeah, that's because we can keep saying, you know, critique yourself, you know, ask yourself the right questions, but this goes back to kind of the Warframe thing, right? Mm-hmm. Huge, insane amounts of hype. And I guarantee, like, there were far more than just the people I was watching that were in it for the hype.
Absolutely.
Whereas a lot of other people actually, it gave them a chance to get the game on stream because they enjoyed it.
Mm-hmm.
And they still enjoy it. There's still a lot of true fan that are playing Warframe regularly.
Even Doc's still playing it.
So. Yeah. So that's...
It's a tough one.
It's hard to avoid the temptation.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I think to some extent you have... Like, you can't... It's okay to cater to the audience a little bit, I think, because at the end of the day, you're still an entertainer. Now, that doesn't mean you have to become something you're not.
No.
But it's okay to change some of what you're offering on your stream to appeal to viewers more, if that makes sense.
Yeah. And so the other side of that is you might not know that it's not you until you try it.
Yeah, that's true.
And it becomes more about recognizing that that's not you and being willing to kind of... make that change and say, like, just openly with your audience, say, this isn't me, I need a change.
Mm-hmm.
And just gauge the response on that, you know.
Yeah, I could see that for sure. Yeah. You know, getting caught up in something that people are watching but you're not really caring about.
Yeah.
That at the end of the day, I think you have to kind of decide what you want to get out of the stream, right?
Yeah.
Because maybe you want to just get a lot of viewers on your stream. And that's fine. You can do whatever you need to. But if you want to feel personally involved and fulfilled in what you're doing on stream, then you might have to sacrifice some viewers for that. But that's a choice you're making.
Yeah.
And at the end of the day, that might be worth it. And so
I think that's actually a very big point in all this that I kind of missed early on is it part of your identity is what you want out of this, right? This is, you know, if you want to just stream and have fun, even if it's with a handful of people.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that becomes part of your identity.
Yeah, absolutely. Eshnut has a follow-up question. Is it bad to ask people like you guys for help or feedback on your identity?
No. That's, I mean, some of your best mentors are going to be other streamers,
mm-hmm.
especially if you have similar approaches to things. Like mm-hmm. they're going to have tried things that you might have thought of or might not have thought of. And it turns out that those things work really well for you. Sometimes better than they worked for the person you're getting the idea from.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And I think to anyone in the chat who's part of the TRUgaming family, I think asking sponsored streamers is a great way to go because all of our sponsored streamers have some form of identity. That's a part of why they got chosen to be sponsored. So they can give you some feedback as people who have an identity already and you can trust them in that sense. So.
Yeah, that's probably the biggest thing I use the Streamer 101 channel for.
Mm-hmm.
You know, sometimes I answer a question with another question and just try to get people to think about it a bit.
Yeah, absolutely. It's a good way to go. I the Knight says, with the cap at the end, have you lost yourself often to have to find your identity multiple times? It's very, very confusing.
Yeah, that's...
Okay, I think that's most of the questions from the chat. We'll keep it open, guys, for anybody else who has a question. In the meantime, just really quickly, anything else you want to add to the podcast that we haven't touched on yet?
No, I think I've covered everything I kind of wanted to talk about today.
Okay.
Hopefully it's been beneficial for everybody.
Yeah, I think it's been an awesome conversation myself, personally. I hope everyone thinks so, too. But awesome. So, any other... games you're playing right now?
Right now I'm going to be, once I'm back, starting into Super Mario Galaxy. I've already been playing it, so I'm going to start a new save file.
Yeah.
That game's addicting. It's a really good game. It's probably one of the best Mario games I've played in recent
years. I've heard good things about it.
I'm waiting for January because I bought my birthday gift to myself. I got Code Vein.
Nice.
On pre-order. There's also a Shadow of the Colossus remake coming out that I'm finally going to get to write this game off my list. I've been wanting to play it.
Oh, you haven't played it yet?
No. So it's going to be like the remake, or I think it's a like complete remake.
Yeah.
Is going to be like my blind playthrough of it.
Wow.
To an extent, because I have watched playthroughs and I know I want to play this game. Like, I know I need to experience it for myself. So I'm very excited about that. That's coming out in 2018. There's already pre-orders for it up on Amazon, etc.
Wow.
Battlefront 2. I'm gonna be playing
Yeah?
that on the True Channel on Friday.
You still getting
That's
it after all the controversy?
After all the controversy, I'm still gonna give it a fair try.
Awesome. Yeah, if you guys don't know, he will actually be in here throughout the week. Pimz is kind of taking over the True office for the week. He'll be in on Friday with White Shadow to do True Talk Live at 10 a.m. Eastern. I'll put up an event for that pretty soon. And then I think Thursday's taking over the actual channel for the stream from like 9 to 3 or so. And then potentially Wednesday he'll be in here again. I don't really
Potentially,
know.
we're
So
not sure yet. I'll probably just do it so I have something to do.
yeah, why not? We're still here. So, okay, Malicious Advice says, would you say it's important to have a gimmick or niche as part of your stream identity that sets you apart from the pack? And if so, how important is it?
I'd say yeah.
Yeah.
Specifically for the niche. That's kind of one of the most important things is finding kind of your rut, as bad
Yep.
as that sounds,
I agree.
that you fit into perfectly, and where you're having the most fun. As for the gimmick, I mean, I'm mostly gimmick free on my stream.
Yeah.
The closest thing I have to being have to a gimmick is being Canadian, and that's something that people have kind of forced upon me.
Yeah. That's true.
That or
Awesome.
that the half American. Valley loves bringing that one out.
Oh my gosh, the better half, he probably says. Yeah, I agree with that. I think so. Like initially, I thought, no, you don't have to have some crazy niche or something. But I think really, if you want to set yourself apart on Twitch, you have to have something that makes it unique. And you can call that a niche or a stick or whatever you want to call it. But you have to have something that you can do that ideally no one else is doing, if you really want to make yourself grow a lot. Now there are some people that will do the same thing as other streamers, and it kind of works for them. So for example, I watch a lot of Widowmaker streams for Overwatch because I love playing Widowmaker. And there's these two streamers, and one gets about, I want to say, turn up the volume. One gets about 500 viewers or so for each stream, and one gets about maybe 100 or so. And they do almost exactly the same thing, but because there was one guy who did it first and does it better, he gets more viewers. And the other guy kind of like, he's still a very good entertaining streamer, but because he's so similar to the other person, he doesn't get that many viewers because they just rather go watch the other guy. So at the end of the day, I think you do have to find something that kind of sets you apart from other people and really finding that niche. So cool. I think that is, like I said, most of the questions for chat. So we'll go ahead and start wrapping things up, guys. Thank you all for coming out to the show. Really appreciate it. We'll be moving, hopefully, to a weekly schedule on StreamKey. So every week this will be coming out. What we'll do is we'll stream it live on the Twitch channel like this, and then export it to things like iTunes, SoundCloud, YouTube, all those later on. So this episode should be going on shortly. But again, thank you guys all for coming out. Pims, where can people find you, dude?
Twitch.tv/thePimz for my Twitch channel. I'm on Twitter as Pimz Digital. I'm really bad at having all the same stuff. Instagram, I'm Matt Pimz.
Yeah, it took me forever to find your Instagram today. It's like Pims Digital, Pims. That's funny.
I should probably fix that. There should be, I think I see a Pimz chat or Pimz command in chat.
Yep, I and I pulled it up. Thank you, I.
Perfect. So for those of you in Twitch chat, that's where you can find me. And I'll be on the Twitch or the TRUgaming channel occasionally,
Yeah.
just helping out with charity streams when I'm actually at a computer.
Actually home for the weekend. Yeah. Cool. Well, thank you guys. I again want to thank everyone who came out to the show, and I hope that you will come out next week. If you have questions, we're going to start taking email questions for this podcast. So if you have a question about your stream, regarding anything, it could be about identity or viewers or ways to grow, social media, anything at all, send me an email at bgreen@truegaming.com, and we'll personally go over your question over the next episode of the show. And it'd be really cool. So that's it for us, guys. Thank you all for coming out, and we will catch you later.
Thanks, everybody.
Adios.